This video was made possible through the support of my patrons. It's 2005. Doctor Who had been off the air for 16 years, but in the city of Cardiff, an old police box was getting revved up by showrunner Russell T. Davis, who had assembled a massive team, along with actors Christopher Eccleston and Billy Piper, to introduce Doctor Who back into the world. History speaks for itself and the lasting impact of the revived series. However, Doctor Who has now officially been back on TV screens for longer than it had initially been away. Does this debut episode Rose actually stand up, or is it just an important footnote in history? My name is Mr. TARDIS, and welcome to my retrospective look back at the revived series of Doctor Who. To make sure you're here with me every step of the way, please be sure to subscribe, hit that bell icon, and let's start our trip of a lifetime. Structurally, I'm not quite sure where to start this review, mainly because this episode can mean so many things to so many different people, and it is also trying to be many things at the same time. Firstly, this series is making a conscious choice to not be a reboot. Our lead was referred to by the creative team as the Ninth Doctor, internally at least. Doctor Who Confidential would show classic series clips, including the TV movie. Returning villains and even props from the classic series would be used. This is a continuation. However, this episode also needed to stand alone, as something for newcomers and a new generation, whilst also establishing a wider universe that can be explored. No more serialized stories with 4, 6, or maybe even longer episode counts. Now, does Russell T. Davis succeed in accomplishing all of this in Rose? Absolutely, because this episode holds up way more than I thought it would. Now, it's not a home run, but it nailed it where it counts, and many of the issues I have with it can be chalked up to nitpicks, but before I get carried away, let me back up. Our story begins with Rose, played by Billy Piper, on an ordinary day with her ordinary family and her ordinary job. However, when running a late night work errand, she gets attacked by shop window dummies in the basement, but is saved by a mysterious eccentric figure, the Ninth Doctor, played by Christopher Eccleston. He blows up her job and accidentally gets her involved in stopping a plot by the Nesting Consciousness, a being that can control all plastic on Earth and wants to take over the planet. But can the Doctor be trusted? And more importantly, is Rose even safe being involved with him? Now, I've got to talk about this opening, the introduction to the Doctor, and the main threat of the episode, the Autons, the latter returning for the first time in 30 years. If it wasn't for the fact that audiences already knew that Billy Piper would be the companion and the main character, this whole opening could easily have been like a cold open for a horror film, you know, where the beautiful blonde gets lost in the basement and gets killed by the villain and then bam, title card. But just before she can meet that grim and dark fate, the Ninth Doctor grabs her hand and announces that it ain't that kind of story, Chief.
Rob.
God, I have so much nostalgia watching this episode, and it does a good job to bombard Rose, and by proxy the audience, with information about living plastic, the Doctor disabling the lift, producing an explosive from his jacket, and the vague threat of death if Rose talks to anyone.
You go on. Go on. Go and have your lovely beans on toast. Don't tell anyone about this, because if you do, you'll get them killed. I'm the Doctor, by the way. What's your name?
Rose.
Nice to meet you, Rose.
Run for your life!
That line never fails to make me laugh. It's been 15, 16 years, and I'm still laughing at it. But before we talk about the characters, let's talk about our primary threat. The Autons were the villains that brought Doctor Who into the 1970s and into colour, and now they're here to usher in a new era of the show. The Autons are such a quietly brilliant choice to open the series. Firstly, fans are happy because this is a classic series element, further hitting home that this is a continuation of what they loved, but they're also able to work absolutely stand alone. Even though shop window dummies have been around for decades, decades, if not centuries, depending on how far back you want to look, they still feel modern and contemporary, and making the villain a faceless, wordless entity, but still a potent threat, means that you don't have a monologuing villain who needs to be developed and established, thus cutting into the runtime, into the burgeoning relationship between the Ninth Doctor and Rose, which is what this episode really is all about. With the Autons, Russell T. Davis gets to have his cake and eat it too, have something from the classic series that also even the uninitiated don't need any sort of context or backstory for. They also tie in very nicely with Clive, who you could interpret as the stand-in for the classic series fan, trying to communicate his love and information for this franchise to a new generation who might not really understand it. Actor Mark Benton was born in the mid-60s, so his character is the right age to have watched Doctor Who during its classic heyday. He might even be old enough to remember when Spearhead from Space and Terror of the Autons were broadcast. And then, when the Autons come to life at the end of the story...
It's true. Everything I read, all the stories, it's all true.
That's basically saying, wait a minute, this happened before in the 1970 story Spearhead from Space. Did you know that they didn't have the budget to show the shop window dummy smashing out of the window, so they just hid it off screen, but now in 2005 they can show them doing it? Also, when the Autons came back in Season 8's Terror of the Autons, they introduced... The next point I have in my notes for this review was actually about to be how they maybe needed to give the Autons a voice, because that might explain why they killed Wilson and then tried to kill Rose at the beginning of the story, but...
How come those plastic things keep coming after me?
Oh, suddenly the entire world revolves around you. You were just an accident. You got in the way, that's all.
It tried to kill me.
It was after me, not you. Last night in the shop, I was there. You blundered in, almost ruined the whole thing. This morning, I was tracking it down. It was tracking me down. The only reason it fixed on you is because you've met me.
Nope, Russell T. Davis, or maybe his script editors, already had that covered. Damn, they're good. But going back to the Autons, they also help to push the big budget production values of the show. These aren't bug-eyed monsters, as Sidney Newman used to call them. Auton stories from the 1970s are kind of infamous for their weak special effects, their obvious mask-wearing and shoddy green screen, but here, they look utterly convincing, including the stretching plastic sound when they move.
Listen to that. Don't you hate that? That is awful.
And there's something wonderfully twisted with having child-sized dummies running around killing innocent shoppers, though I'm amazed that these incredible assaults on London's high street that leaves it on fire hardly ever gets brought up again when Rose comes back in future episodes. Also, I know this is such a nitpick, but it's on the same level. During the Doctor and Rose's scuffle with the plastic arm, they destroy the living room, yet there's no phone call from a concerned Jackie, no mention of it when she speaks to her on the phone later. I don't blame the story though, because that might just slow things down, and if there's one word to describe Rose, the episode, it's fast. It just keeps moving, with nary a scene or moment wasted. The characters are either learning something new, or walking, though often running, to their next destination. Further bolstered by Murray Gold's energized Westminster Bridge theme.
Hold on a minute, you can't just go swanning off.
Yes, I can. Here I am. This is me, swanning off.
See ya.
But that arm was moving. It tried to kill me.
10 out of 10 for observation.
You can't just walk away. That's not fair. You've
got to
tell me what's going on.
No, don't.
Yet it's not hurried, it's not rushed. It feels like everything in the story that needs adequate development gets it, and that characters like the Doctor and Rose get the best chance to make the best first impression possible. So let's talk about the Doctor. When I first saw this in 2005, I did not have any point of comparison, other than, you know, Peter Cushing.
Most exciting.
And I was hooked and captivated by this Doctor immediately. Well, watching Rose back with hindsight, I don't think any other Doctor since Tom Baker has hit the ground running this effectively. However, credit where it's due, let's be fair, it's because the audience are watching the Doctor through the perspective of Rose Tyler. We don't get a scene in Rose where the audience see the Doctor detached from her viewpoint. This is even communicated visually at the dinner table where Auton, Mickey and Rose are talking, and they don't even know it's the Doctor holding the champagne bottle for some time. The audience only gets confirmation when our two characters at the table look up and see him standing there. We only see the Doctor's past through resources given to her by Clive. We don't get to see the inside of the TARDIS proper until Rose can actually comprehend what's going on inside that box. I think that's why the Ninth Doctor makes such a strong first impression, because the episode wholeheartedly commits to this otherworldly figure being filtered through a different lens. Prior Doctors like Troughton, Pertwee, Baker, Davison basically got right back up off the floor and were surrounded by friends or companions who knew about him, whereas this episode does not have that luxury. This reads like a spiritual successor to the first ever Doctor Who serial, An Unearthly Child, where the Doctor's granddaughter Susan is framed through the perspective of the teachers Ian and Barbara, and they take the audience through the emotional journey of meeting the Doctor and stepping inside the TARDIS for the first time. Compare this with the 1996 TV movie. The Seventh Doctor is travelling alone, but the audience still gets to see what he's up to. The Doctor is the point of view character. It's one reason why the 1996 TV movie was pretty well regarded by fans, but newcomers might not have appreciated that perspective. They might have needed to have been grounded before this talk of Skaro and Time Lords and Gallifrey, etc. And because in Rose we're meeting the Doctor mid-adventure instead of dealing with an episode or two of regeneration trauma or some equivalent, it means that we're meeting a Doctor who, metaphorically speaking, already has some miles on him, and he's comfortable in his skin. He's able to be enigmatic, charming, and also have a real sense of melancholy about him. This Doctor may walk and talk like a human, but when he's talking to Rose about feeling the turn of the earth beneath his feet, an explanation of how he sees the fleeting and finite nature of life in the universe, the fact that he isn't one of us is sealed, and how he closes that speech by making a joke with the little plastic arm, and then he turns around and his face is almost blank. The talk of beans on toast, price wars, and culture shock, it's a front. And he's definitely got some anger issues to deal with.
You were right, you are alien.
Look, if I did forget some kid called Mickey...
Yeah, he's not a kid.
It's because I'm busy trying to save the life of every stupid ape blundering about on top of this planet, all right?
All right?
Yes, it is.
But despite all of that, Eccleston is still really funny.
What's a police public call box?
It's a telephone box from the 1950s. It's a disguise.
He says that so earnestly. Obviously, we're speaking from the benefit of hindsight, but I'm amazed that Eccleston thought that he couldn't do comedy or light-hearted material, because, in my opinion, it's all subjective, but I think it fits him perfectly.
And why did you want to be the Doctor?
Because Russell T. Davies wrote it, and because it was an audience and an area television that I hadn't worked in. I've not had the privilege to act for children, really. And because I'm constantly told that I'm not funny and I'm not charming, and they were some of the demands in the role, so I felt it was a big gamble. There's two reasons to do it: Russell T. Davies and the gamble, and I like a gamble. I think it's important as an actor or in any sphere of life to do the things that frighten you most.
But one thing that absolutely sets this incarnation apart from his predecessors is the working class sensibilities. Not only because we have working class performer Christopher Eccleston involved, but mainly the setting of the Powell estate, where shouting neighbours can be heard at night, where gossip is rife, where Rose and Mickey live in cramped accommodation, and Mickey, despite thinking of himself as a cool lad, drives a beat-up yellow Beetle, and Rose needs to go to Mickey's place to use his computer. The location filming makes Rose feel so grounded, as the Doctor and Rose walk in an environment that could be outside your window right now. A far cry from the classic series' three-walled sets, quarries, forests, and airfields, though we still get the obligatory London landmarks like Westminster Bridge, Big Ben, the Thames, and the Millennium Wheel. And what makes Rose, the character, stand out so well in this story that makes her companion material is that she may be afraid, but she never falls behind when the Doctor runs. She asks the right questions, she pulls the Doctor into her flat when he tries to escape. This isn't a story about Rose being meek and defenseless and then saving the Doctor her at the end, so he brings her on board as a thank you. This is a woman who already has a strong will and a capacity for greatness, but no outlet for it. Stuck in a dead-end job in an estate after leaving school for a man in a relationship that didn't work out, and a medal for gymnastics, but only the bronze, which is a lovely detail. And then, all of a sudden, this man turns up and shows her that there's a massive universe out there. And in no small detail, he sounds a bit like her.
If you are an alien, how comes you sound like you're from the north?
Lots of planets have a north.
This isn't a received pronunciation establishment figure, the type of figure that turned Eccleston off the classic series in the first place, but instead, he's a relatable lens to view a gateway into time and space.
Now, you're Doctor Who. He's got a nice northern accent and remarkably different from the others. Did you go back at any point and go, you know, I'm going to keep that bit of Doctor Who? On which bits can you jump?
I feel the old series, I think what we've jettisoned is the sexism of the underwritten female role. And also, you know, the defining characteristics of Doctor Who are, to a certain extent, are heroism and intelligence. And there seemed to be an equation drawn with RP, received pronunciation, that was the sole area, really. And you know, I felt that it was time to, along with the sexism, it was time for that to be kicked out, you know.
If there's one area where Rose doesn't come across well, it's the fact that she doesn't seem to remotely care or notice or bring up Mickey's behaviour when he's been replaced. She literally has no idea that something's wrong with her boyfriend until that cork flies into his plastic face. Also, I don't like how she laughs at her mum over the phone after the invasion has stopped and Jackie's basically traumatised. Yeah, I know Rose is still technically a teenager at 19 years old, but it does her no favours. Also, I don't begrudge Rose for leaving Mickey stood in the street when she gets an invite into the TARDIS, but...
By the way, did I mention it also travels in time?
Thanks.
Thanks for what?
Exactly.
Like, that's just cold. I imagine there's an alternative ending floating out there, like some sort of parody, where Rose says that to Mickey, steps into the TARDIS, and then the TARDIS malfunctions and stops working, so Rose now has to just deal with what she just said to him. Like I said, I get it, but I don't like it. Am I alone in this? You know, please let me know in the comment section what you think of this stuff. In fact, you know, just leave a comment anyway. It appeases the YouTube algorithm. But let's talk about possibly the most drastic change from the classic series to the new, the production. Gone are the days of cheap TV shows where you could put two or three cameras in a space and almost record a stage play before moving to a soundstage or a location for more specific shots. No, the way dramas were made and produced had drastically changed in the 21st century, and Rose reflects this change with a much more dynamic visual style. Fast motion when we look at London, a near-constant musical score, honest-to-God atmosphere, and attention to detail when it comes to lighting, etc. The production isn't perfect, though. Not all of the special effects hold up, the sound mixing is all over the place, though that could be because of my Blu-ray. I don't know, I can barely hear the Doctor talking during his pivotal speech to Rose.
The ground beneath our feet is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, and the entire planet is hurtling around the sun at 67,000 miles an hour, and I can feel it. We're falling through space, you and me. Clinging to the skin of this tiny little world, and if we let go...
The background extras in the pizza restaurant really don't seem to react to Auton Mickey destroying the place, and you can see Rose yelling in this shot, but there's no audio. And did this shot of the Doctor twisting the hatch mechanism to the Nestine's lair really need this many cuts? However, the production comes together where it counts the most, and I can forgive all of the above cut corners if it means we could get a set as incredible as the massive coral TARDIS interior. It might not be as large a space as the TV movie interior, but it feels like a space which is more economically filled and with more intent. I love the layers and the circles within circles, which naturally draws your gaze to the central column. This TARDIS is now looked back on as a bit, quote, grunge, but I think the low lighting and the hazy visuals is a deliberate contrast to the pure white, overlit TARDIS of the classic series. I love this interior. The reveal is perfect as well, where Rose catches a glimpse inside that is unseen to the audience before she runs around the exterior to double check, and then runs back inside, and the audience are finally treated to this alien, impossible space. Due to the nature of the classic series, Doctor Who simply has never had to do a TARDIS interior reveal since 1963. Its dimensions are just assumed and accepted by the supporting cast to the point of banality. But now, for a new audience in 2005, you only get one chance to make a first impression and to establish the TARDIS, and it did it perfectly. Even the story detail of making the initial location of this scene a dingy back alley contrast with the London skyline and the Thames later on feels thoughtful to communicate to the audience very quickly that yes, this box does travel. Like, imagine if the first trip that Rose took in the TARDIS was from one back alley to another back alley, or one street to another street. No, it feels immediate. And speaking of communication, do you want to know what the most important dialogue exchange of the story is? The one that lets the audience know what type of show they're in for?
Well then, tip in your antiplastic and let's go.
I'm not here to kill it. I've got to give it a chance.
Much like the opening horror sequence being subverted, the audience are expecting maybe a big showdown and a slaughter underneath the Millennium Wheel, only for the Doctor to, once again, let everyone know that an outcome like that is a failure and a last resort. Even if it does boil down to an argument about bureaucracy.
Oh, don't give me that. This is an invasion, plain and simple. Don't talk about constitutional rights.
The show that basically acted as the catalyst for the BBC to give Doctor Who another shot was Buffy the Vampire Slayer, which had been a massive imported hit on BBC Two, showing that genre entertainment aimed at young adults can thrive. However, Buffy is literally destined to fight and combat evil threats, you know, through combat, through fighting. That's what drives those stories. However, the Doctor in this episode demonstrates that this isn't the case in this franchise, despite being seen by the higher-ups at the BBC seeing this revival as a spiritual successor to Buffy. The Doctor has brought insurance with him, but it's just that. It's insurance, it's something he doesn't want to use. He literally asks the nesting consciousness, here reimagined as a lava-like blob, to leave. And it's not performative, he's formal, he asks for permission to approach, and when he says that he's not the Nestine's enemy, you know, it's not a put-on, he means it.
I was not attacking you, I'm here to help, I'm not your enemy, I swear, I'm not.
This also leads into some of the story threads and world-building of the series. Rose, the episode, shows restraint in not showing its hand way too early. For classic series fans or newcomers with an eye for detail, there are questions surrounding why he's travelling alone. The Doctor refers to a war that destroyed the Nestine's food supplies.
Its food stock was destroyed in the war, all its protein planets rotted, so Earth, dinner.
And in the climactic confrontation, the Doctor brings up that not only was the Nestine's world far from the only casualty of this war, but that he fought in it.
That's not true. I should know. I was there. I fought in the war. It wasn't my fault. I saved your world. I couldn't save any of them.
But we'll touch on that more next time. But let's start wrapping up here. To be frank, I was expecting Rose to have charm, to have some fun nostalgia, but not much more than that. But I was really surprised at how well this pilot holds up. It's really smartly assembled. It doesn't tip its hat too much and gives plenty of room for these characters and the format to grow, but it also doesn't feel compromised or half-baked in the character and story department, and even if it did, there's a lot to be said about the sheer energy and kinetic pace of the structure that forces it to hold together. You know, objects in motion tend to stay in motion, right? Now, its production is rough around the edges. Rose, the companion, might leave a sour taste in her final moments, but in terms of the checklist of introducing a compelling new Doctor, a relatable new companion, making the show feel modern, respecting the classic, while also leaving room for future growth, Rose, it does tick all of those boxes. But let's see if Doctor Who can keep this momentum going, as the TARDIS goes further into the future than we'd ever seen it go before. to the planet's end. Join me next time on the trip of a lifetime as we bear witness to the end of the world. Hey folks, thanks so much for taking the time to watch my first installment in my Trip of a Lifetime series. I really hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, please consider hitting that like button because it really helps me out, and you can also subscribe to keep up to date on all of my upcoming videos in this series. And also, if you want to appease the almighty YouTube algorithm, leave any comments in the comment section below. I do read them all genuinely. And also, if you'd like to support me via Patreon, like these wonderful Adonises here, whose names should be scrolling along the screen, then you can do. There's information in the description below. You can get these videos early, sometimes weeks and months in advance because of YouTube's copyright stuff. You can also get access to a private Mr. TARDIS Discord server and way more other perks, and I'd like to give a particular shout out to these patrons. Anne Neubauer, Matthew Perry, James Raby, Dean Jones, Andrew Blewett, Callum Baird, Daniel Davis, Dylan Whitaker, Flabu, Joseph Adams, Katie Maxwell, Palex, Raven Woods, Rebecca Hill, Shazeb Mangi, The Brit Sniper, Zachary Taylor, aka MarioFanboy15, Dan Morrison, Darius, Nathaniel Holden, Samuel Brooks, Zarby555, and Luke Jenkins. Thanks so much for watching this installment, and we'll see you next week for the end of the world.